Hi everybody, we are here to talk about sustainable menstruation today, and we do have Ganesh. He's the director SheCup with us, and we have Aparna from Stylish Suitcase to take this conversation forward. They will be joining us in a minute. Hi Ganesh, are you there?
Hello, I'm good, Pallavi. How are you?
I'm good too. Thanks for joining.
Thank you for having me.
I'm just waiting for Aparna to join.
Sure.
Let's just give her a second.
Yep.
How have you been otherwise? How is the lockdown is still there in Bombay, right?
Are you
based out of Mumbai?
Yes. I'm based out of Mumbai. We still like under lockdown as such, but things seem to be improving in Maharashtra. So let's hope things get better with time.
Yeah.
How about Bangalore? I heard you guys went under lockdown also recently.
Yeah, we are under a kind of a partial lockdown right now. But we are hearing that it's going to get a little bit more serious from this weekend.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, so I think she's trying to join. Aparna, are you there? Aparna? It says she joined, but...
Oh, yeah. There she is.
Hi. How are you?
Hi. Can you hear me? Good, good.
Yes,
can you hear me?
Okay. Yes, we can.
Hello.
So I'll just do a round of introductions and then we'll get started. So Ganesh is the director, Shika. And Ganesh, like you know, Aparna is a sustainability advocate. And she's very active when it comes to talking about concepts that are more, the everyday kind of things which we face on a continuous basis. And she's very vocal. She's very clear about how she talks about it also. So we'll just get started. The aim of this chat is to answer a few questions around the sustainable methods of handling menstruation, which is typically to talk about the menstrual cup usage. People have certain questions and queries around their concerns around how to move from the conventional methods like the tampons and the pads, sanitary pads, to a menstrual cup. And then if you also throw a little bit of light on what motivated you to really engage in this kind of a venture, and then how is it going for you, and what kind of feedback and reviews do you keep getting, that'll be great.
Definitely.
So over to you.
Thank you and nice to meet you, Aparna, virtually. This organization was started by my father and my uncle back in 2009. And the story behind it is actually very interesting and also very personal and touching to me and my family. So we lost a very close family member, in our immediate family, to cervical cancer. Now, we lost her not because, cervical cancer, like any other, like most cancers, is curable at a very early stage of detected. But she wouldn't voice out her pains and, whatever she was going through. That was because of the kind of society she was raised in. These things are considered to be taboo, and people don't really voice their feelings out, or you know, even if they're going through pains. So, and when we found out about it, it was a little too late for any medical professional to do anything about it. So it was it really touched all of us. Like I was quite young back then, but I wasn't that young to not understand what was going on and what kind of taboo was prevalent around the society to do with such a with such topics, you know. And it was quite moving for all of us. Like we were quite disturbed with this entire event. And so my father and my uncle, they started they decided to start working in this field. And I was always closely associated with this organization, as we tried to we initially started with introducing menstrual hygiene and these kind of practices like in the society. And talk about it, like basically start a conversation about it in different parts of the society. So I was always part of it, like I was closely associated with it. 7-8 years back, I started working with it full, like on a very like on the ground level, you know, like answering calls and helping customers find out like, you know, what they're going through and how it is. And 4 years back, I officially started holding a title in this organization. So basically, I'm forwarding the vision of breaking the period taboo and, you know, starting a conversation about these things. But also, we took it a step further, like with the introduction of She Cup, the menstrual cup that we launched in 2010. We took it a step further from there because we realized that breaking the taboo is one part of the entire picture, right? Like when you start a conversation, there are multiple problems that come with it, you know, like with this taboo benefits only organizations that are into unsustainable menstrual practices that not only pollute the environment as such, but also harm the human body because of the chemicals and the plastic that is in those products. So we really thought about it and we tried to understand that what can we do? How can we take this a step further from just breaking the taboo, you know, like from just talking about it. So that's when we started introducing this concept of sustainable menstruation. And you know, we worked with multiple medical professionals, you know, like multiple gynecologists and medical research scientists who were working in this field. To an extent, we also worked with the president of the Fraternity of Obstetrics and Gynecology in India, which is Dr. Mahapatra. And with them, like with their inputs and with their guidance, we developed the first menstrual cup, which was completely developed in Asia, like in India, and we are the first menstrual cup brands in Asia. So instead of back then when we started, there were 3-4 brands in the entire world, right? Like two of them were from America, a couple of them were from Europe. But instead of getting those products over here and marketing those products over here, we decided to do our own research and develop our own products in the country so that we can so that we have a more effective reach in the society, in the Indian society especially. That was our initial aim, and then from there we grew global. So it is so, as I said, you know, like as this conversation also entails us talking about menstruation to say daughters and like how mothers introduce these things. So what we also found out was usually menstrual practices, right? Like with our experiences doing the menstrual hygiene management program in multiple parts of the country, from big corporations to small government organizations to gram panchayats to rural areas, what we found out was menstrual habits usually stem from is a generational thing, right? Like it usually stems from say mother to daughter, aunt to niece, or you know, like a older sister to a younger sibling. So we get massively, like in our society it's more of a hush hush thing, like we don't speak about it much, but it usually stems from it usually stems from a very close family member. So it's quite interesting to also understand that because it is not spoken about so much and it usually is influenced, where do we also need to understand where do mothers or say older sisters get influenced from? They get influenced mm-hmm. from either their own parents or from the advertisements that are going on or are prevalent in the society or on social media or wherever. You know, so it's very interesting correct. Why we see menstrual cups are not that popular as of now, even though they've been in existence since 1932, right? Like the first menstrual cup that was patented was back in 1932. So it's, wow. it's almost going to
really?
Be...
Really?
Like, yeah.
Yeah, I read about this.
Yeah, so it's almost amazing. Like in a decade's time, it's going to be 100 years, you know, like since menstrual cups have been... widely available, like not widely available, but have been in existence. And it's very interesting. It's very interesting why, and we will, in later in the talk, we will dive deep into why it is not, you know, like not so prevalent in the society as of now. And there are multiple cultural yeah. and socioeconomic yeah. reasons for it. And we shall, but before that, I would like to hear your perspectives on, you know, like about how you introduce periods
yeah,
or
so,
menstrual hygiene.
So this is yeah. news to me, though. This is news to me also, though. I thought I've done my homework and I've read a little bit about it, but but yeah, I mean, it seems like it's almost as old as the usual things that are used during menstruation. So this is yeah. something which definitely has been influenced by the generations which have really passed on these practices to us and then before us. So there was no visibility to how it's, or probably there was no importance that was given to a sustainable mean of menstruation also, because in any which ways it's a process that, you know, you don't talk too much about and you
absolutely.
Don't indulge into too but many activities about- while you are actually
yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I had read that the shortage of rubber, World War II, and then and during that period, then, you know, tampons and all these kind of things also started coming out. So convenience always takes over. And I
yeah.
think that wasn't marketed or didn't have those marketing budgets.
Think,
there are a couple of reasons it didn't succeed, is what I understood. Yeah.
I think more than if you really understand the cultural reasons, right? Like more than convenience, it is okay. So you know, pads and tampons make perfect economic sense for any business, right? Like because you get
exactly
once you get the person hooked on to the product,
yeah.
they and it's disposable. You're gonna keep you're gonna have that customer buy your products again and again and again and again. Whilst if you say like I can speak for She Cup, if you buy a She Cup per se, you will you know, like you don't need to buy another menstrual cup for at least 10 years. That's what we say as a company because we've been in existence for the past 12 years. But if but our internal extended lifetime studies show that. You know, you can use this particular She Cup for your entire menstrual lifetime if used correctly, if not overboiled, if not like, you know, if you don't add any chemicals for cleaning and things of that nature. So that's
mm-hmm.
it's something that for any business out there, say multinational corporations that have, you know, that sell pads and tampons. It doesn't make economic sense, you know, like it absolutely doesn't make any economic sense. So the
it's like any other pharma product. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any product.
Like
I think.
Yeah.
Correct.
A supplement kind of a thing which you get hooked
yeah.
on to and then you really don't want to because you don't, it's so convenient. You've been there, you've been using it. And
absolutely.
And of course that there are some bodily changes also which happen because of that, and then you have that fear that, you know, I move away from it and how will things change for me.
Right.
So in that context, I mean, I think like Ganesh shared with me last time that, you know, how mothers are the biggest influencers of these things on their daughters. And I had the same conversation with Aparna, and then she was in the process of actually having her older one mm-hmm. move in this direction. But of course, Ganesh, you shared that information with me, and I passed it on to her that, you know, yeah, maybe we are doing it too early, because she's just about 13. And I think for menstrual cups, girls should get started on it at a particular age. I'll let you talk about it.
So basically, like, we have done, you know, like with doctors and gynecologists, we have done these extensive clinical trials where young girls from the age of 12, 13 who have started menstruating they have used the menstrual cup and things like that. But what happens is, like, to be honest, like, what happens is young girls and young menstruators, usually it's such a daunting process when it all starts, right? Like, it's something very new that is happening to the body, and it's already so overwhelming and so much to take in. In that, if you introduce a different kind of a process altogether, you know, like, that takes a little bit of understanding, that takes a little bit of technique and method to how to insert, how to use, it becomes a very overwhelming process for young girls, and something that's going inside the body, you know, they are so, like, not even young girls, to be honest, like, even older menstruators are sometimes very daunted with the entire process, you know, like, initially in the first two cycles, when they're still getting used to it, it's quite daunting for them. But once they get used to it, it's much easier. They never look back at pads. So that's the same thing with, like, young girls also. But as they grow older, like, as menstruators grow older, like, you know, nearing the age of 15, 16, where they are, they have gone through the periods for, say, a year, a couple of years, and, you know, like, it becomes a natural process for them also. It becomes easier for them to switch, because that time, it is, you know, like, that time, obviously, it is still a very very irritating process to wear pads and stuff like that, to have that bulky and itchy feeling. But they are also looking forward to changing. But, you know, as you grow older, you make it your comfort zone. Even if you're uncomfortable, that becomes your comfort zone, and you're more resistant to making the sustainable switch. So what I would suggest is, like, you know, like, the cloth pads is something that young girls, you know, who are at the age of 30.
Oh, underwear is also the period underwear, I think.
Correct.
Come out with it yet? My German friend forwarded one to me, and my American, I think this American brand called Things. But I'm so surprised this happens always when you're looking for an Indian brand. I mean, and then you don't find an Indian brand making a period underwear. You know, because I'm sure that the young, like, for 13, it's a big market, right? Like, and it's one of the best options. I got reusable ones, and honestly, it's very bulky. Even I didn't like it, and she's been complaining. And going back to the, you know, like, also, I think, okay, we have to educate our daughters, but the problem is, even so many women my age or younger, 30s, are not into it. So if she's going to be the only one in her class, and her friends' mothers don't know about it, I think for me, the largest issue is that I think people our age, mothers, have to be first moved into this, then going to the daughters, because as he said, it's very difficult. It's a difficult time. The body changes. And if you're the only one, it's already like, mommy, nobody else in my class even knows about this. Their mommies don't even talk about it. So it's like, it's too much already. Like, being this one mom who's, you know, already considered extremely alternative in the sustainable lifestyle. So I just not pushed. Of course, I had these conversations, and they understand it, and I'm happy. And she's still 13, and I'm hoping... I was just going to order Things, but I was waiting for an Indian brand, because I really just want an Indian, or even a Thai, you know, because I live in Thailand. But there is no period underwear. And right now for her in Thailand, there is no option. Like, even those, India has biodegradable ones, which are like coconut fiber, banana fiber. I think pads are being made in India, right?
But, you know, like, you know, like, biodegradable pads, like, so what happens is, usually these biodegradable pads use certain amount of plastics, right? Like, I introduced myself as the director of this organization, but through my academic backing, I'm also an innovation and sustainability specialist, right? So, obviously, working in this field, I look at many different products, such as pads and biodegradable pads and things of that nature. So most of these biodegradable pads use a certain amount of plastic in them so that they don't leak. Right? Like, so
when, really? Even 100% sustainable claim? Okay.
So,
I mean, I saw some Indian brands that tried it, yeah.
Yeah, so what happens is with these biodegradable pads, because of the, even if it is a biodegradable plastic, biodegradable plastic usually works in the sense of it has cross-linking polymers, which have carbs or protein embedded in them. So when the bacteria, when it's put in the ground, the bacteria wants to eat the carb or the protein or the enzyme that has been embedded in the cross-linking polymer. It eats through the plastic and reaches the enzyme. But in that process, the bacteria is not designed to, naturally not designed to eat or digest the plastic. So it just bites through it and creates a lot of microplastic. Now, microplastic is a major problem and a much bigger problem than macroplastic, because it not only enters it not only pollutes
water.
the water, but it also enters our own food chain. You know, it gets accumulated in our digestive systems, and also with other plants and animals. You know, when they take this microplastic in, it affects them. So it doesn't really solve the problem as such, but it enhances the problem in a much, much larger way that is not really thought about or is not really common to understand. Because obviously these kind of things require a certain amount of research and a certain amount of, also understanding of the field as to how these plastic polymers work and things of that nature, which is not really prevalent. Our addiction, like our societal addiction to plastic, I'm sure you guys.
And convenience, exactly. Anything disposable and convenient that is a problem, I understand. That has to go, but I think the second option after the cup should be the underwear or the reusable pad. I mean, these are the only real sustainable options.
Definitely.
That's what I understand. Yeah. So, any questions
Yeah, not yet. So, just to reiterate, I mean, Aparna, you have been doing this. Is it a fairly complicated process to even share this information? I mean, because, like Ganesh said, there is anyway so much information to be shared right now. I mean, of course, it's not all now. You would have shared it at different points in time. But then to along with all this, to introduce a certain kind of a product, which of course is not as easy to use, not for that particular age group, does it make it very daunting?
Not at all, I think, because my kids already know this is our lifestyle, right? In terms, just not about the cup, in terms of I compost food, we try and eat a plant-based diet as much as possible. I mean, we just do try and reduce our individual footprint as much as possible. And my younger one also goes for climate change. You know, she participates in certain things in school. She draws, you've seen some of her things. So some of it's come from them. In fact, my older one was, when she was 10 years, she used to love pork. And in Thailand, as I always say, meat is heavily subsidized. Broccoli is more expensive. I just hope these kind of policies change after the pandemic, this whole food, all these things, right? Like, so it's, but we changed. So I think it's not at all difficult for me, because my children understand these things. I mean,
that happening all over. I mean, on a large scale.
I think
they know
what it is. I mean, I think they know these things. I mean, there's no running away. Like, you see it. I mean, they also understand the bushfire or the whale, which carried the baby for so long. I mean, these are all just there. We are driving ourselves towards extinction, and this generation has to face it. So, I think they're aware of it from school. And the only thing what's an individual control is, of course, you can be an activist and push governments to change policies, all of that. But I think at the individual level, we can make changes, right? So, and when it comes to a menstrual cup, it's the easiest. Like, for everything else, people argue, this is plant-based is expensive, that is this issue, that issue. Or even composting, people might say, I don't have a balcony. But there is really no excuse for this. It's cheaper, it's more convenient, it's more sustainable. Yeah. It's like, what is holding you back, right? This is the perfect, like, this I wish I discovered it earlier. That's my only regret. I think a menstrual cup should be the easiest switch for anybody because it's actually more comfortable and convenient, and it's just a coincidence I got the She cup. I mean, it was just a few years back, I was at my cousin's house, and like, you know, she recommended this, and the next day it was Amazon, I don't know where, I just ordered it and it came. And for me, I think I was lucky, or maybe the She cup is perfect. It's just that my first period, I was used to it. It took 1, 2, 3 trials, of course. Yeah. You know, everybody's vagina, cervix. I mean, different people have different issues for sure. And people have to figure it out. People keep saying, will it leak? Or what is the size? I honestly don't have the answers for that because I didn't have any of those issues with the She cup. I just got it. Mm-hmm. That was it. It was like, as I said, by the end of the first period, I had mastered it, I felt, you know. So I was like, okay, this is good.
Aparna, so that's actually the thing with most She cup users, right? Like, these apprehensions are before buying the cup, and these apprehensions about, say, you know, like what size and things like that, I think it also stems back to the previous topic, you know, that we were talking about, that how you know, like, because these products last a long time, you know, it doesn't make as much as economic sense. So most organizations over there make different sizes of the cup, which can be used at like different ages and things like that. But what we realized, so in the initial years of developing this product, right, like we put in like around 1.5 years of experimentation, research, and clinical trials and things of that nature, working with doctors and stuff. So what we realized is the total menstrual fluid that is secreted during a period cycle is between 20 to 80 ml, right? And on an average being 50 to 60 ml. So the She cup can hold around 28 ml of menstrual fluid. And secondly, like, so that means like you can wear it on a heavy flow day without it being a problem, and without it leaking or without it staining and things like that. And it can be worn up to 12, like as an organization, we say 10 to 12 hours, but we've had people who've come to us and said, you know, like, oh, I just forgot about it because it's so comfortable and I've been wearing it for 24 hours.
Absolutely. I feel the same. Yeah. Like, it's so comfortable. You saw those pictures in the mangrove. I mean, you're so deep in water, slushy. I could have never done that with a pad or a tampon. First of all, for me, the biggest worry will be the toxins in the environment. Like, correct. I think of myself as a secondary thing. Different people switch for different reasons. For me, it was just the landfill pollution. But when I was wearing the She cup, it was like, so comfortable to just do that activity and slush, water, everything, but nothing, no leakage, nothing.
Yeah.
And I came back, that's the thing. It's really convenient,
Yeah, so that's the thing, right? Like, so we stand, that's why to make this entire, firstly, like, this entire topic has been heavily tabooed, right? Like, people make it more
that's
complicated.
That's the biggest issue, I feel, yeah.
Yeah, people make it more complicated than it actually is. So that's why
you don't have a community where you can go and talk about these things, or even because within your household, of course, this is the first time that you are the one who's trying it. So whom do you ask? And then outside, it's anyways a taboo, so you can't really talk so freely about it. And there is, absolutely, I don't think there is a, I'm sure there are forums, but then, you know, people have these issues which they think that, you know, if I talk about this, maybe I'm exposing too much of myself, and then maybe I'll not be considered as somebody who's like a normal human being. So they don't really even come out and ask these questions. So I think it's a great start for us to really break this taboo, because it's high time that we can't really do this to our kids who would. I mean, I'm sure they don't even think of it as such a big taboo, but then of course with time they might get into the same mind frame like all of us did, right? Because we did break a few, but then of course there's just too much around it. So just to aid and abet that, I think this is a great forum, what the conversations that are happening here.
So Aparna, it's all sorry Pallavi, it's also to do with it's also to do with the media conditioning, right? Like the
organizations
you know, like heavily taboo this thing, and they say, they tell you to stay free, they tell you to whisper about it and hush hush about it, you know. You know what I mean, right? Like so that because of that, like, it creates this mindset around this topic, you know. So as I was saying before, also, like, when we stand, there is a reason why we standardize the size, because we ourselves are heavily sustainability oriented people, right? Like all of us in our family are very sustainability driven people, and we didn't want to, like, the problem that we were trying to eradicate was menstrual hygiene waste, like, obviously break the taboo, but also the menstrual hygiene waste that has been created by unsustainable menstrual practices.
So
our aim wasn't to sell more of these to the same people, right? Like that was never our aim. Our aim was to standardize the process, to make it much more simpler, educate the society, and empower them to adopt these sustainable menstrual practices. So, like, you know, like, there are many, as you rightly mentioned before, Aparna, there are these many apprehensions, you know, like, what size should I buy, what you know, like, whether my cervix is high or low, and things of that nature. But we worked, like, that's why we worked with a lot of gynecologists to actually figure this out, right? Like, and we understood that the size of the cervix doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter, because the size of the cup depends on the amount of menstrual flow you have. Now, we standardize the size so that you can use it throughout your menstrual lifetime and not just one particular point in your menstrual lifetime, so that we don't become part of the menstrual waste problem, but we actively try to reduce it. So that is one. Secondly, you know, like, there are some people who say, okay, like, you know, like, who use the cup and then they say, oh, it's leaking and it's staining and things like that. So there are two reasons for it, right? Like, initially, when you start using a menstrual cup, whether it's a she cup or any other menstrual cup, there is a certain amount of change that you go through, right? Like, a very different consumer journey than, say, using a pad or a tampon. So it takes a couple of cycles for you to get used to it, like, obviously the insertion where the cup needs to remain and things like that, and whether it forms a proper suction or no. So that is one. And the second reason is usually, you know, like, because of after delivery, or say, you know, because of this excessive sedentary lifestyle that we are used to, the pelvic floor muscles become weak. And because of that, they can't hold the menstrual cup or the she cup in that particular place that it is meant to be. And that's why it slides down. So now those things, like, obviously these are recommended by gynecs and things like that, and medical professionals also, that you are to improve your pelvic floor muscles, you need to do some Kegel exercises and enhance those the capability of those muscles. Now, and we've seen, like, in the past also, right, like, we've seen many people come to us with these problems. We've recommended the same, that just Google or YouTube, you know, some Kegel exercises and do it. Like, after they do it for, say, you know, like, after they have had this incident of leakage and things like that, and then they come to us and we tell them to do these Kegel exercises, the next period they're perfectly fine. They can use the she cup without any problem, because it gives your body enough time for you to develop those muscles, you know, to hold the she cup again for your next
tighten
cycle.
Tighten those muscles.
Absolutely. So those are a few learnings also, you know, like, these things we also didn't know about it initially. Like, obviously, when we were speaking, like, in the initial years, we were also hearing all these problems that people were having around our product. And over the years, we have enhanced our products to make it in such a way. So even right now, like, if you see, like, you know, if you see the market, like, there are many other cheaper brands and things like that, like, obviously, in the in the market. And one of the most common questions that we get is, why is she cup expensive? Like, why is it a premium? So what what is the actual reason behind it being a premium product is the quality of the materials that we use. Now, as Aparna said, like, you know, back in 1932, these guys made menstrual cups, like post-World War, they made it out of rubber and they made it out of like some other material. So these kind of things are also prevalent today in the market, right? Like people make it out of rubber, or people make it out of plastic, or people make it out of cheap silicone, you know, which is not really conducive in our experience. But our products, like if you see on our website also, our products have been tested, and only then we finalize. Like, so the products have gone through intrication tests, implementation tests, and all these various tests and multiple clinical trials. I'm proud to actually say that we are one of the most heavily endorsed brands out there, you know. And so even when Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they came to India to do a study on menstrual hygiene and around the taboo of menstrual hygiene and sustainable waste, instead of getting an American brand over here, they chose us to partner with them because they found our brand to be the most heavily endorsed by senior gynecologists, have gone through multiple clinical trials. So with them, there were around 960 women in the rural parts of Bihar who took part in the study with us, and with them, and with a third party research organization also, which was funded by them. And with them, we did this extensive study of menstrual hygiene waste and the taboos and the things around menstrual hygiene, and how adoption of a menstrual cup will be much easier. So even today, you know, like I, in my own personal experience and working with this organization and being a part of this community, I would say people in the rural areas are more open to these kind of ideas and adoption of sustainable menstrual practices, because there are a few reasons to it, right? Like as Aparna said, she went into the mangroves like half a body deep into water and things like that. So not only are they connected with nature, but also their makes it very uncomfortable for them to adopt, say, like a pad or tampon, where you're feeling uncomfortable. Like, women usually in rural areas work physically on the fields or the farms, or are doing some sort of physical manual labor on a regular basis. And having 4 days off or 5 days off or 7 days off or whatever during your period is not a luxury that they can afford, to be very honest. So, right, like it's something that urban people can afford, but they can't. So, a few other reasons. So, we've been doing these projects in, say, Leh Ladakh and Spiti Valley also. The reason of motivation for them is very different. The reason of motivation for them is because 6 months during the winter, I told you about this, Aparna, Pallavi, last time, right? 6 months during the winter season, no access. Through roads, no access through, like, air is also very this thing. So that's why the pad and the tampon supplies get limited and get used up faster. So that's, but you know, you don't stop menstruating when you're on your during the winters. So that's why they adopted She Cup, because it became more convenient for them. You know, coming back to the same point as what Aparna said, like, it becomes more of a convenience thing for them, because you don't need to buy anything else. Like, you can just sterilize this and keep using it over and over and over again for those 5-6 months where you have no access to anything. So that's how we've seen the Indian society evolve around this conversation that we initially started, and you know, took it forward towards sustainable menstruation.
Yeah, and I'm so it's so adorable, the passion with which you really talk about all of this. I mean, you were really, isn't it, Aparna? I mean, the way he
It's from the whole concept of sustainability and zero waste, right?
Yes.
Talking about it. That's what's important. I think that's how you educate people, the concept of there are two kinds of people I've seen. Like there are a lot of people who are very, very environmentally conscious who want to switch. So once they know that regular pads have toxins and plastic and they're just lying on earth in these landfills, it's just an immediate, for me, that itself was shocking, and you're surprised you didn't know that for so many years. And then there are other kind who probably do it for their own comfort. So both a menstrual cup is for, you know, has benefits for everybody, right? So like perfect number one choice. When I sent you the article also, I written one here for a local magazine. I said for sustainable, I said menstruation, first choice. But now today I'm learning about these biodegradable pads having plastic. I wasn't sure because I've been told that, you know, coconut fiber or bamboo fiber can biodegrade.
Yeah, I understood that also, that those are the best option for,
because they make cups also
followed like that, by the cup. Right?
But I'm saying here also now
the lacing under those biodegradable pads so that they do not leak. At least most of the brands that I have seen, you know, like that I have experienced with, you know, like, and we also called for some of their products to check out for ourselves, like
best is, like, I always even sometimes even for those, you know, eco-friendly bags and all that, just put in your own compost and just check it in like 6 months or 7 months, right? You'll figure out how genuine something is. Yeah. I mean, if you take it to a lab and test it, fine. But for those who are conscious, but I really wish, like, now I'm just feeling a little sad because I thought that is an option for some people, you know, at least when they're 13 to 16, whatever, right? And I don't know, because I worked for another NGO and they were promoting that also. Now I'm learning something. But, you know, it's all, you're constantly learning and unlearning, and especially with sustainability.
I would like to add one more point over there, right? Like, it also, so these kind of things, right? Like, in my own experience, like, this is not that major a point, but I think it's worthwhile to understand, you know, the entire picture is, so these crops are usually cash crops, which are grown on land, on pieces of land, right? Like, and when they are converted into, say, biodegradable pads or whatever, there is a certain amount of water that goes in. There may be a certain amount of pesticides and fertilizers that also go in them. Apart from those chemicals and the water consumption of these certain crops, say, like bamboo or, say, you know, like any other...
But coconut fiber, like... coconut waste, coconut fiber, you call the weaver sarees also. My understanding was I met a weaver in some village near Chennai, and he's come in some Guinness book and all of that also. And then he was telling me that he was not talking about pads, he was just talking about coconut fiber being in excess, and you can convert it into different things, is what he told me. But I am understanding what you're saying. When you make your pad, of course, the sari and the bag is a different story. But for a pad, you need to have something which is holding onto a liquid.
And then, apart from these points also, right, like with the comparison between a cash crop and a food crop and things like that, like a food scarcity and even all those things. Apart from that, when you dispose, say, even a biodegradable pad, it has biological matter on it, which becomes a breeding ground for vector-borne diseases, you know, because it also depends on how you dispose it, you know, like, so most people would just chuck it into the dustbin or somewhere, or just throw it. And, you know, like, not everywhere, not in every community, the recycling or the reuse or the disposable mechanism.
Segregation also is not there. Yeah.
Correct.
So I want to ask you a question. Yeah, okay. And I'm really curious if why India still doesn't have then a period underwear. Wouldn't that be a big, big, easy thing for so many young kids? I mean, it just seems like things that the American brand or whatever, like my German friend got this German brand, taken off everywhere else. How can India in 2021 not have a period underwear? Like, is there a reason for that?
I'm not sure about, like, what is the reason. Like, for us, like, as an organization, we are solely dedicated to menstrual cups because we find it outweighing everything else. But also with the period underwear, right? Like, there has to be a certain amount of absorption material, which is also to do with which is also to do with plastic and things like that, because naturally, even naturally absorbing, naturally absorbent materials are laced with certain amount of chemicals or certain amount of plastic to it to make them that absorbent. So that is one of the reasons why we don't dabble into those kind of practices to do with our sustainability vision. But it definitely would work for younger people, as you rightly said. The thing was that again, right? Like even why I like apart from Shika, why I also advocate about say reusable pads. Which our associates like EcoFem make is because those pads are washable, right? Like you can wash off the biological matter from it and then dry it off and hang it. You don't need to dispose the pad off, and disposal of the pad, say like a biodegradable pad or a normal pad, also leads to these vector-borne diseases that I said, right? Like because it leads to all these things, so malaria, dengue, and all these vector-borne diseases, it becomes a breeding ground for them. So it's very like to understand the whole concept of sustainability. Apart from the whole picture of sustainability, we also need to understand these other factors that influence influence the use of these products, as well as what happens post disposal of such a product. So That's something to something very interesting to to keep in mind, and most people don't really think about it from these many angles. Obviously, we ourselves didn't think about it initially, but because being in the field for so long, hearing things, seeing new products come up over the past decade and things like that, we ourselves get educated about these things on a regular basis. And so that is one of the reasons why that's actually one of the reasons why I know so much about it, because I've seen them firsthand. Like I've seen these products firsthand. We've seen like what goes into them and what is claimed, or the kind of greenwashing that we were talking about, Pallavi, before, you remember. Those kind of things are also prevalent in the society. That's one of the reasons why people also opt for these options and not menstrual cups, because
the conventional methods. So let's just go to these few questions that you've received, because I think Aparna, Ganesh answered the ones that you had received, right? Do you have any specific okay, so there is one here which says, by what age it is recommended for young girls to use a she cup? I think you are suggesting 16 to 17, right, Ganesh?
Yeah, 15. 15 is also a good age. As generations further on, girls are getting periods earlier. Very soon.
Correct.
We heard some girls get periods at the age of 9, 8, 9 also. So that's just the way of evolution, like societal evolution that we are seeing. So every time in every decade, the menstrual age, the age would further reduce. As of now in this time and being, we recommend that 15, 16 would be a good age to start adopting a menstrual cup or a sheet cup rather than pads or tampons or
So if I understand, there is no physical limitation to using a cup sooner, but it is more about your mental conditioning, about how exposed you are to the concept and how deeper you are into the process, so that it's not a very overwhelming process for you, right?
Exactly.
That's what I understand, correct?
That's exactly the point, because once in the initial days, if you have a bad experience, you're never going to go back to it in your entire lifetime. You're never going to adopt such a practice again because you're So that's one of the reasons why we say 15, 16 is a good age to experiment and try, so I think that's that.
Okay, and then we have somebody saying that they want to ask questions, but there are no questions here. Okay. And then we have a couple of comments really I mean, praising you for being able to talk so well about a concept which is not a very very male driven I mean, people shy away from it, right? So yeah. I mean, even now I it's not very easy to because there is no father daughter connection when it comes to menstruation. Yeah, mm-hmm. I hardly see that happening even in this age and time. It is very rare that people have a conversation. It's mostly the mother's thing to really bear. Yeah. So with that, I think if we get any further questions, we'll definitely direct it your way. But I think Our Better Planet is really proud to be partnering with Chica, because I really can sense your commitment to the product through the way you really passionately talk about it and the way you are actually so sold into the concept. And it's not only a product, it almost seems like that to me for you, because it is something that it's an awareness that you're trying to create. And you're doing a great job at it, I think. So thanks so much for
that's the thing, Aparna, sorry Pallavi, that's the thing, right? Like we are not trying to sell, like, say, She Cup, right? Like we are not here to, like, it's not a business as such. It's a socio-economic enterprise. We truly believe in education. Like, we truly believe in letting the society know that, okay, there is something better out there. There is something more to those days. You know, like, you don't need to hide out in those days. You don't need to let those days limit you in any sense altogether. Yeah. In any sense, you know, whether it is, you know, like, during those days, you can't go for a swim because you're wearing a pad or you're wearing a tampon.
Correct.
You know, you don't, like, that doesn't need to happen, you know, like, and we truly believe in that empowerment. We truly believe in that, that commitment to the cause, because I think that is what is more important. Today our organization, like, today the concept of our organization is that we think, this is our research and our thing, like, whatever studies that we have done, we think this is the answer to the problem. But tomorrow, if that changes and something better comes along, we are committed to the cause and not the product itself. We want to solve that problem of sustainable menstruation. So that was, like, my closing comments on that. But thank you so much for having me over here. And it was such a pleasure to have this live with you guys.
Yeah, thank you so much. And thanks, Aparna, for joining us and sharing your experience, because it is the most vital. It's so fresh, and we know that, you know, this is what people are going through. And then through you, we got so many questions, and I hope we answered a few. And
I think you answered everything. I think I just also want to finish up with, it just comes down to awareness. I think overall with sustainability, that's the issue. So I'm just going to talk to school also after now. Again, we're in lockdown. If we could have these conversations with younger kids and in international schools, you know, we'll get that moving. We went for Meat Free Mondays, and that's been passed on. So we'll talk to my Zero Waste group. I think it's just about really educating kids, not just from mother to daughter, from school, from a larger, you know, perspective.
Yes,
from all directions, creating awareness and...
Also, like, one of my suggestions to you would be, like, you know, like, when you do some programs like these, you know, please don't exclude, like, men from it or boys from it, right? Like, because it's very important for them to also understand that it is because we think, right, like, you know, so we initially started these conversations, right? Like, and what happened is people now claim themselves to be menstrual health management experts and things like that. And what they do is usually they gather a group of women and they talk about it and things like that, right? But that is what we initially did, was not that. Everyone was welcome.
No, it is just limiting the conversation.
Exactly. Yeah,
it doesn't help. But Ganesh, it's very difficult, because it's not something that you can very easily achieve. And to that point, I would like to bring, I would like to talk a little bit about these books which are available for girls.
Yes.
There's one by Niyati Shah, there's one by Tiska Chopra.
And the good thing that I liked about these books was that they are actually talking about the boy side of puberty also. So there are so many changes which are happening there, which we are not aware of. And then because of that, there is no empathy, you know.
Yeah.
They are not aware of what bodily changes are happening to the other sex. And it really creates unnecessary curiosity and leads to unnecessary kind of, you know, behaviors.
Yes.
So if we can curb that, then why not?
Yeah.
But I think that's a bigger, that's another topic for discussion.
So that was just my suggestion, you know, because we ourselves, like when we did menstrual health management programs, we ourselves were men who were conducting these kind of programs, right? Like, so it actually helped us break the taboo in a more effective way.
I'm sure.
When men came to our conversation and they left being, you know, they used to tell us, we actually didn't know that. And not like young boys or, you know, like you
men.
Know, 24, 25, but men like who are like, you know, nearing 40s or are in their 50s, you know, like who were just there and were like, oh, wow, we didn't know about that. I'm going to buy it for my wife. I'm going to buy it for my girlfriend or whatever, you know, like those kind of conversations also happened with them and things like that. So which is very interesting and very, very, you know, like very helpful for the society also. I think.
So we'll keep doing this over and over again, and we'll try to, because the idea that our better planet is based on the same concept that you're talking about for She Cup. It's not about the product. As and when practices change, if a better practice comes up, we will definitely adapt. We will ask our audience to adapt because it's all about the impact that we create. So with that, I'll just end this conversation here and thank you guys so much for joining us. And people who were listening to us, if you have any questions, do send it our way and we'll try to answer them as best as possible. Thank you. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.